How's it going, wrestling fans? Thanks for tuning into this episode of the Wrestle Report, episode 43 with Phil and Don. I am Phil.
And I'm Don.
WrestleMania has came and went, and we hope everybody enjoyed that show. And if you didn't, there was a plethora of other shows that went down over the weekend. Part of the many reasons that make WrestleMania weekend great, but we will mostly be talking about WrestleMania. Couple of housekeeping things first. Sorry about not doing a true preview to WrestleMania. I had a little bit of a family emergency. Not able to get that done. Luckily, everything's cool now. Everyone's good. Everyone's healthy. That's all that matters. But we planned to do it the Friday before, and that's when everything went down. So that's on me. I didn't feel as bad about it because we did pretty much review all the important stuff. We just didn't get through like the filler and the fluff that they added. And there was plenty of that on this show, let me tell you. But I think a good place to start with WrestleMania weekend is, like I said, all the shows that happened before it. Because even if you don't love the WWE product, and they always bring it on Mania, we know that, this show, I'll just go right off the bat and say it, was a really fun weekend of wrestling, regardless of what you think about the E right now. It's definitely been a great show. But before any of that even happened, Ring of Honor has come back. I kind of want to kick it off with that. I watched a little bit of that. That was headlined, obviously. It wasn't the main event, but it probably should have been. FTR and the Briscoes, fantastic match. Really, like, if it didn't feel like WrestleMania weekend on Friday, it really did after that match. So ROH making waves. I think they did about over 20,000 buys for the pay-per-view, which doesn't sound like a lot when you're comparing it to WWE or AEW or something, but they did like 2,100 buys the last pay-per-view they did. So a big jump up. So props to Ring of Honor for really kicking off the weekend.
Oh yeah, for sure, man. And it was a good card altogether. This was actually my first time actually watching ROH like in its entirety,
like live,
yeah.
Like a live
show. yeah. I can't speak for shit, but but yeah, man, it was a good card. Definitely, I thought maybe the Briscoes and FTR should have main evented it, mm-hmm. But I was okay with the Jonathan Gresham because I'm a big fan of his.
Yeah, he's fantastic, and really also like. I get they had a bit of a title unification match themselves. They had like an interim champion. So I get that going on last, but this should have probably been semi-main. If I remember correctly, it was like an hour into like a 2.5-3 hour show. So it was kind of in no man's land. Like, again, man, it's WrestleMania weekend. You know how many people probably like, that's the match I wanted to see. I'm going to go try to catch the GCW show that's 6 miles up the road. Like, I don't doubt that some people in the arena, which they sold about 3,000 between 2,000 and 3,000 tickets from what I was reading. Before these matches were announced, they'd only sold like 250 tickets, which part of that is you're not buying tickets to a show you don't know matches for, right? I mean, for the most part. So like, it sounds extreme, but really it's like, okay, cool. They're going to be in my town. Let me see what the card is. And then I'll think about going. So, you know, they did, there was also some good, you know, Brian Cage showed up. We're starting to see a little bit of the AEW influence thrown in there. I put on the pre-show because I wasn't doing anything else. First match, I had Colt Cabana, and I'm like, I'm in. I'm sitting right here. I'm watching this whole thing. So that was cool. Blake Christian, I believe he faced, which is a young dude that's got a lot of potential. You know, AEW, like I said, kind of sprinkled across this show, and it kind of gives us a little bit better of an idea what to expect from Ring of Honor moving forward. I think we'll really know after this show, this really being the kickoff. But I mean, besides that, man, we had GCW, New Japan Strong had a show. WrestleCon had this, like, Triple A versus the World, I believe it was called. So they were even involved. Joey Janela's Spring Break, like I was talking about a minute ago. And of course, NXT Stand and Deliver, which I weirdly enjoyed the matinee time slot of like 1 o'clock. That was almost I kind of enjoyed that. I didn't think I was going to. I guess it really just comes down to if I have plans during the day or not leading into this. But that was kind of enjoyable. I'll just say right now, I didn't watch a full show of anything, but I definitely like dipped my toe in every one of these shows for at least a match or two. But it was fun. I almost put it this way. It's like the March Madness of wrestling. Like that first weekend where there's just like 12 games on 5 different channels and you don't like, do I have this channel? What is True TV? You know, it was very similar to that to me. You know, it was just a great fun, just to kick off even before WrestleMania, indie wrestling after the past 2 years of, you know, COVID kind of having its way with it. This is the first time it felt like the indies were thriving all around, not just your outliers like GCW and stuff. Everybody seemed to have a productive weekend, and that was great to see.
Oh yeah, man. It was definitely a good weekend of professional wrestling or wrestling, whatever you want to say. I was highly entertained. And I think you saw my, I think you saw my tweet. I was like, you know, this was a good weekend of wrestling. Like, I really, really enjoyed myself. And I still continue watching it, even though I watched about maybe 20 hours of wrestling to do at the weekend.
In three days, and then you still got, you know, the Raw after Mania and everything. So yeah, it kept going. I mean, you went to NXT yesterday. We'll try and talk about that in a minute too. But you know, just a lot of stuff going on. Which, after that great lead-in, brought us to night one of WrestleMania on a Saturday. I will go on the record and saying, and I think a lot of people might agree with me, looking at this card before the nights kicked off, I think a lot of people thought they were going to enjoy night two more just because the matches on paper looked better. But I got to say, I think I enjoyed night one overall more than night two. What do you think?
I grade it on two different scales. Mm-hmm. One, was I entertained?
Right.
And two, who actually, like, well, was the booking okay?
Yeah.
I would say night one, definitely, if I'm wanting to sit there and watch an actual, like, professional wrestling, night one was it. Mm-hmm. But if I want to be entertained, night two was it.
What if you want to be sports entertained?
If I want to be sports entertained, then it'd be night two.
Okay, gotcha. So there's a lot of matches on this card. There's, if you add the matches that weren't really matches here, we're looking at 16 matches. So some of this stuff we're going to blow through. Some of this stuff we'll take a deep dive on. I think you guys will be able to tell what is what. I do want to take an extra minute on that. Normally, I didn't think I was going to care about this match. But the opener, the Usos versus Shinsuke and Rick Boogs, just getting started, about 6 minutes in. The way this match was going, I thought like Shinsuke and Boogs were maybe going to win the titles.
Yeah.
And Boogs blows out his ACL, knee, whatever it might have been.
I think it was patella. Or
I got to say, I thought it was part of the gimmick for a minute because they've like, that's been part of the story where he was like had a brace on it. And then he like on SmackDown faked that, you know, oh, his knee's good or whatever. So when he like collapsed on the thing, and really, I don't know which Uso is which, especially when they're running around like that. But like the second Uso didn't really get scooped up into the fireman's carry. He basically like jumped on when Boogs was on his way up, which is obviously when your knee's going to be most vulnerable because it's pushing up and then it gets pushed back down. So I thought it was part of the match, but the fact that it ended like a minute later, it's pretty obvious what was happening. And then he was in the corner, you know, EMTs and stuff were around him and like, I've had my fair share of like shots at Rick Boogs, but like without a doubt, the dude is over. The people like the guy. I think at the moment he's more over than Shinsuke. Like it started as like Shinsuke helps legitimize him. And at this point he's like, the people love him when he comes out with the guitar and everything. So just kind of a crappy way to start Mania. And I do wish a lucky, you know, a quick recovery for him. Cause like I said, didn't get the guy in the beginning, but like, there's no doubt that he's over for sure. So that definitely not the highest of notes, I would say, to start Mania.
Yeah, not really. When I saw it too, I thought it was basically a work. I thought it was just, oh, he's okay. He's going to come back and get the heat and win and pick up the win for them. But yeah, it was legit. And then when I saw the doctors actually come up to him and talk, and speak with them, I was like, okay, yeah he's legit hurt.
Because when the Usos get out of the ring and they walk by, like he's still in the same corner by the steps that he was when he rolled out, like, and I don't even know that Shinsuke really got to tag him. I think he just kind of went in and kept the match going. So like, and the match ended so quickly after that injury that you kind of knew that would happen. So yeah. Tough luck for him. Hope to see him back, you know, in the near future. And maybe hopefully we've seen this in the past where like the moment kind of passes them by and they don't get that title that they were meant to win and stuff. So hopefully, you know, if this is a relatively quick thing, if this is like a month or two or something, I don't know. I think his popularity that he's built with Shinsuke will last and he'll come out to a big pop and like, who knows what they'll do with him. So like, again, sour note to start. But we did press on. We then had Drew McIntyre and Happy Corbin with Madcap Moss. And I will also admit, Rick Boogs and Madcap Moss, I've mixed up their names a lot just because they're like a very similar type of person. And Madcap Moss coming off the Andre Battle Royal on SmackDown because
Andrew, you know, Andrew, I don't know if you saw that picture.
Yes, I did. Yeah, they messed up the graphic. That was hilarious. But he won the Andre Battle Royal, which I still think should be on WrestleMania. And if not on WrestleMania, here's one thing I do want to backtrack for a minute. We had two-hour pre-shows that had zero matches on them. That needs to change. And I've actually spoke with someone that was at WrestleMania who went into AT&T Stadium the minute the doors opened, basically, and they didn't have the pre-show on the screens in the stadium. So they didn't know what was going on. People were like going to their phones, like, oh, they're interviewing Jake Paul next or whatever. Like, not only so they didn't even have it on the stadium. So like, who's that for? I put it on the first night when I realized there's no matches. I didn't put it on the second night. So there was zero reason why you couldn't do at minimum a women's battle royal on one night and a men's battle royal on the next night. But whatever.
Put the IC and the US title in there too.
Use the mid-card champions. I mean, it's a little crazy of an idea, Don, but yeah, you know, it might just work.
Hire me, Vince. Absolutely. Shit.
Absolutely, man. I mean, there's so many of these matches that could have had, you know, the mid-card titles on. And like, for some of these matches, you want guys on the cards. Like, that's what the Battle Royal was for. It was literally you figured it out. You got to 21 and then you said, hit me again. It's like, we're going to take this battle royal of literally everyone that doesn't have anything going on, name it after Andre the Giant, make this ridiculously cool trophy. And like, it's going to kind of matter to people sort of. And like, that was perfect. It was the perfect pre-show product, triple P's right there. But like, yeah, I don't know how they got to 21 and they said, hit me, and they outthought the room. And now it's on SmackDown with like 12 people. But this match went exactly how you expected it, except I don't know if I had Drew McIntyre cutting the ropes on my bingo card at the end there. But yeah, I mean, this is what you expected. Drew's on the show, big pop, you know, he's probably the number one babyface on SmackDown, I would say right now, if not one, definitely two. So this was very paint by numbers, 8 minutes, you know, get in, get off, get out. This might have been better to start the show because of how paint by numbers it was, but you know, not much else to say about this.
Yep. I mean, it was cool. Fun fact, my stepfather actually met Madcap because my stepdad lives in Texas. My mom and my stepdad lives in Texas, right. And he works for the airline, and he actually sent me a picture of Vince's private jet.
Oh wow.
Coming into his into where he works at. Nice. And he met Madcap Moss. He was going to meet Sheamus, but Sheamus was too busy talking to other people, but he actually had a conversation with Madcap.
That's pretty cool. Was he nice to him and everything?
Yeah he said he was a real cool dude. He was going to give him free tickets to go to WrestleMania, actually.
Hell yeah. All right, so any bad thing I've said about Madcap in the past, I gotta take back at least half of it, because that's very cool. Did you see your stepdad watches the product? He knew who he was, or he just knew there was wrestlers coming in?
He's not a casual fan like he used to be, but he knows who Madcap is because he Googled him and stuff.
Yeah. And I mean, this isn't a dig. If you know who Madcap Moss is, you're pretty in tune in the product. It's not like Sheamus walking by, you know, like I know people that don't watch wrestling that have seen Sheamus before. Like, he's just under that, like, Randy Orton meme level by now, because he's been around for like 15 years, which is crazy to think about. But next was the Miz and Logan Paul against the Mysterios. Logan Paul, there's no other way to say it, very impressive in this match. Like, somebody said to me, we had some people over, and was just there to hang out, like, didn't know. They were like, that guy looks like Logan Paul. They thought it was just a wrestler that just happened to look like him, because he blended into the scene so well. His gear was great. Him and Miz had the matching gear, whatever. They get the win too, which like I kind of expected, because there's no harm, no foul. Like, Rey Mysterio's bulletproof. Dominic's still too young for like it to really matter to him or anything. But and then the weird heel turn at the end, the heel on the heel turn, I guess you could say. But I guess what I've heard is like Logan Paul wants to stick around and do more things. But part of wanting to do that is like, you know, this is a guy that hasn't always had the best public image, so he wants, if he's going to do this, he wants to kind of be a good guy and help aid that. So that's what I've heard is the reason for that, because it didn't make a lot of sense in that moment. Maybe it will moving forward, but the match itself was great, and Logan Paul is the talk of the town to like the entertainment industry. I don't know if it's over Pat McAfee's performance, and obviously we get to that later, but like it's on par. Like, it's crazy how well some of these guys are coming in, and when they treat it right and they do it correctly and they take it seriously and they have pros like the Miz and Rey Mysterio, like, pulling the strings, how great they can look in something like this.
Oh yeah, man. I was utterly surprised on how good he was. I had a feeling that he was going to be decent just because he is an athlete.
Yeah, like, absolutely.
Who, like, yes, he's a YouTuber. He fought Floyd Mayweather, bro.
And didn't die.
You could call it stage, you could call it whatever, but still, he fought Floyd Mayweather. I will say this, though. He looked like he was gassed.
Sure, yeah. I don't think you realize, if you haven't done it before, how easy your stamina, like boxing stamina and wrestling stamina, two completely different things.
Yeah.
You know, you run back and forth those ropes 3 or 4 times. That's like a round's worth of exertion right there.
Yeah. When I get gassed, I know you can see it. You can see, like, under my eyes, I get bags, mm-hmm. and they get really, really dark.
Yeah.
And that was going on with Logan.
Did see that, yeah.
Yeah, like when he did the 3 Amigos, it looked like he was trying to rest every single time he was doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, he was really impressive.
Got some air on that frog splash too.
Yeah. He got some bunnies on there.
And it's funny, like, of all moves, the frog splash kind of makes and breaks a celebrity, because everyone thinks, oh, you just go up and jump off, and like, we love Snoop Dogg, but like, we've seen a bad frog splash before, and this wasn't that. This was done well. This was hit flush. He didn't hit his feet on the ground and then just kind of fall over. Like, probably a top three celebrity splash, I will say. Definitely up there for sure.
Now, I have a question.
Sure.
Who did it better? Bad Bunny or Logan Paul?
The splash or just wrestling?
Well, just wrestling altogether.
It's probably pretty even, but Logan just looks the part, which I hate to be that superficial about it, but like, when Bad Bunny did it, it looked like you downloaded Bad Bunny in the video game, and like, it didn't mesh. Like, you know how like you go to community creations and you can download like Ronald McDonald, and he'll like go in there and like do all the moves properly, but it doesn't look right.
Yeah.
And maybe you might even come down to like, Logan Paul had gear where Bad Bunny was largely just in like regular clothes. So that has nothing to do with how good or bad they are, but I'll give it to Logan Paul by a hair.
Same.
Get it, hair, Bad Bunny. Yeah. I didn't even.
I'm only here all week. I'm here all week, guys.
Here all week. I was here all week. Yeah. I had plenty of shit to watch. Next up is what a lot of people probably called the match of night one. And it's not, if it's not this, it's the match that precedes it. Bianca Belair defeating Becky Lynch for the Raw Women's Championship. This was a lot of fun. It was kind of in no man's land in the middle of the card, and that did not affect a thing. And really, it's because you hadn't seen anything crazy yet, like Miz and Rey Mysterio and Logan Paul. Like, that was fun. That was an enjoyable match. But between Corbin and Drew being whatever it was, and the Usos match being cut short, like, they're just getting started. This was really the first thing they had to like really jump up and down about. This was awesome. Perfectly 20 minutes. Not too short, not too long. Told the story you wanted to tell. Definitely looked like Becky was going to win a time or two, which like wouldn't have been out of the realm of possibility. Like, some people might have been upset about it, but like, this was definitely Bianca's moment. This really doesn't excuse the squash to get us here, but it does a lot to help with that, I would say.
Yeah, I mean, I thoroughly enjoyed this match. This match for me was the match of the night and second match of the weekend. Just because I like the story they told in the whole whole match. It was really spot on, and I love the entrances. I'm a sucker for a good entrance, especially a WrestleMania entrance at that.
While we're talking entrances too, what'd you think of the stage? I thought it was simple but done really well. Just the giant ass star that kind of came down to make like a tunnel.
That was pretty cool. I mean, unless you're AJ Styles, that was pretty cool.
But yeah, overall, like I said, entrance is great. And like, when they started and they did like the handshake into like a quick, like, I'm like, they're not going to do this to her again. I'm like,
yeah.
My mind was like, is that why it's in the middle of the card? Because they're going to, you know, fuck her over again. But no, that's not what happened, luckily. But no, great, great stuff. And this is really like, considering there was no pre-show, I feel like if you're there, you see this and you're like, all right, now I'm at WrestleMania. I don't know quite what I was at before, because it really, it, this kicked it into like third or fourth gear and it only went up from there. So this really, like, this really was the, to me, WrestleMania started right here.
Now if I had one like criticism about the placement of the car of mm-hmm. this match, I would have had this kicking off WrestleMania.
I mean, I do think it, because the Usos are great. We know the Usos are great. Yeah. If that match could have had its full thing, it probably would have served its purpose of the, but obviously, you know, hindsight's 20/20, as Cam Newton says, or 50, however he says it. But yeah, it would have been great to start that way. I do see the pattern here, because like both nights start with the tag team championship matches. So like maybe that's what they were going for, which I get, that's fine. Had they, you know, again, knowing what we know now, yes, would have been a fantastic opener.
Oh yeah, for sure.
So next up we have, like I said, if not match of the night, easily one of the moments of the night. Seth Rollins is in the ring. He waited way too long. I get they're building the suspense. they used the Kurt Angle pyro, I heard, to start that off. And then there it is, adrenaline in my soul, the WWE signed Cody Rhodes. And when I first heard the music, I will fully admit, my first emotion was sadness. I was like, damn, they really did it. Not like, I didn't storm off like I did when Brock won the Rumble. You were at my house for that one. It wasn't one of the, I didn't leave. I just took a big swig of my beer and I'm like, all right, let's see what happens next. And after that moment, I enjoyed every bit of it. When I was like once I accepted, this is what it is now. Because the second he gets off the Cody Vader, he's probably the biggest baby face they have now.
Just right
at that moment. Raw, SmackDown, don't care.
Don't care.
So, and this match was, it told the story to get us here. The reason I didn't, and I would have said this had we got to do our full preview, but like, this is a Seth Rollins story that has Cody Rhodes in it. Like, because we didn't know he was going to be there until he was there. But the second he was, this became a Cody Rhodes story that had Seth Rollins in it, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
And
I get you.
They do have, like, I didn't even think about the whole, like, NXT, like, first NXT champion, Dusty got to hand him the title. They call the original NXT class Dusty's Kids. Like, all this kind of has come out in the past day or two. That, again, if they would have debuted Cody 2-3 weeks ago, and we could have thrown that out there and built this story a little better. But I think what it comes down to is, like, this was one match. They shook hands the next night. They might have shook hands the night of. I kind of forget. This wasn't meant to be a long program. This was just meant to be the vehicle that got Cody there. So I guess if they're not worried about that being his first true program, then it's okay. But it was a surreal moment. Didn't change a damn thing about him. He walked right out of Daly's place and right into Dallas. And I did laugh that, like, I don't even think the match was over. And it was like, get your Cody Rhodes t-shirt here on WWE Shop. Yeah. I had to post the Austin Powers meme that was like, fook me, that was fast. You know, like, that was, a lot of emotions. Like I said, first sadness, then acceptance, then entertainment, I guess. And with the win, I guess some sense of like pride, because I'm watching, you know, Billy and Jake were over and Billy's like, I'm not convinced that he's winning. And I'm like, I don't know what they had to give him to get him here, but that should have been not even number one. That should have been I got to go over Rollins, cause like he was cool with my dad or whatever. But like, if you're going to bring me into Mania, I can't lose, you know, like you just can't do it that way. So this was fantastic. This was my match of the night, because the moment and the match together combined to just narrowly beat Bianca and Becky's match. But this is that WrestleMania moment that we haven't gotten in the past few years, because it's just been Roman against whoever, Brock against whoever. When Roman beat Edge, and if we had got like Edge and Roman one-on-one and they didn't shoehorn Daniel Bryan in and Edge actually won, like that would have been something like this in a way, because he's gone for 9 years. The one thing I didn't like, and I know I'm going long on this, but and we turn into a drinking game. Drink every time one of the announcers was like, basically like, oh, of course Seth is not doing well. He didn't have any time to prepare. Like, they said that at least 10 times in the match. Yeah. And when Seth came out on Raw, I thought they were going to run the match back and be like, well, I didn't have time to prepare, so of course I'm not going to do well. So that was like my one. You can say that like once, like, who would have expected the American Nightmare? Like, how do you plan for the American Nightmare? But then like leave it at that. So that was my one nitpick. But when you look up WrestleMania moments in the dictionary, this is now going to be there. This was incredible. Yeah.
You know what popped me was when he did the cartwheel.
And the Stardust thing. Yeah,
that was awesome. Mm. I tweeted, I was like, man, so much Goosies, yo. The Goosies was going crazy, bro. Mm. I was in awe the whole time, bro. When he walked down, from when I saw the stupid ass tattoo on the screen, I was like, he is actually in WWE. Wow. He had the whole entrance, his whole presentation from AEW was copy and paste onto WWE.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big deal when you think of things. Because now you got people thinking like, who's gonna be next? Yeah. Who's gonna be next to be that next deflection from AEW to WWE?
I mean, the last guy that they copy and pasted, like, this is me, this is what brought me here, and this is who I want to be in your company, was AJ Styles. Like, yes, he got new music, but he didn't really have, like, Get Ready to Fly is owned by Impact. You can't do anything about that. And in New Japan, he didn't have like a signature song. He just had the Bullet Club theme. So like, they gave him a new song and everything, and you know, They Don't Want None is a great song. But himself, it was the same. He came right from Japan into that Royal Rumble. And that's the last dude they really did that way, you know. And that kind of transitions to the Good Brothers too. They were the guys they were in Japan when they got there. But this was this was everything. If you had to show up, this is, again, I didn't love the build necessarily, because it was a Cody story. They didn't have Cody in it until the last minute, I guess. But that's how they chose to do it. But now it's the start of something. It's not the end of something. This isn't the end of the story. This is where it begins. So like. And he's done so much media over the past three days, and I've eaten it all up. I've watched and listened to it all. He was on The Bump today, which apparently is no longer a podcast. It's more of a YouTube show. Shows how long it's been since I think the last time I listened to it was like when Jeff Hardy came back from injury and they had him on there. So that was probably a year ago now.
Yeah, the last time I saw it was a year ago when Molly Holly got introduced into.
That's right. Yep. That's probably the last time for me. So he did do the promo on Raw. We'll just do all the Cody stuff now, that way we can run through everything else. But he did the promo on Raw about like Dusty, you know, he got to hold the belt. He never won the belt. And like, he had told that story on like three of the interviews between his match and Raw. And I felt like he kind of had to push the emotion to tell it again. Cause it's like, if you tell even if it's a tough story, if you tell a story three or four times, it gets a little easier to tell. Mm-hmm. So I think like, you know, he told it on the Ringer interview. We told it on the Ariel Helwani interview. And he like quickly mentioned it on the third one I listened to. I think it was the Variety, right? That was like the first guy he spoke with.
Yeah.
And he mentioned it. So like, it made that a little bit easier to talk about. But I did appreciate the bluntness of like, this is why I'm here. You know, like, I have a mission and this is exactly what I'm here to do. Like, granted, he might get distracted and derailed as he's in the company longer, but the one thing I ask is like, don't just make him another guy, make him as important as Roman, make it, you know, like when AJ came in, I kind of said that. I was like, and Nakamura too, because he was like this Japanese legend, right? Like have him wrestle once a month on TV maybe and make it special every time. Like, do that with Cody, at least in the beginning. Obviously, if he becomes your champion, he's got to be more involved with the presentation and stuff. But yeah, make like great start. Don't fuck this up, I guess, is where I'm going with this.
Oh yeah, man. And and they actually did a good job with it, because that, if you look at both nights put together, that match was the second longest match.
Yeah, the only thing longer than that was on night two, and it was Edge and AJ, which we'll get to that too in a minute. Right before we get off the Cody stuff, we have not done a top three in a while. And Cody, one of the things he did mention in the interview was like, another reason I left is, you know, I couldn't win the world title there. I wrestled everybody I wanted to wrestle there, which I don't know that that's totally true, especially with the influx of talent that came in. But he did mention, he's like, what do you expect me to do? Be like a 15-time TNT champion? Like, what else do you want me to do? So, excuse me. Quickly, we'll do a quick top three. What are three things in AEW that if Cody was going to leave, if you knew he was going to leave, you're like, I wish he could have done this first. So okay. I kind of mentioned this to you earlier in the day.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have any off the top of your head, because I do have my three, but you go ahead.
I got my three. I have, I wish that MJF and Cody Rhodes had another match.
Okay.
Because they only, because they only really had only one match, really.
Yeah.
That was the one that had, that if he loses, he can't go for a title.
Mm-hmm.
I would have loved, this is number two, I would have loved to see him find a loophole in the fact that he couldn't go for the title. And like, because he's Fuego de Sol too.
Fuego does.
I would love to for him just to do that and mm-hmm. and win the championship that way. And then number one, love to see him go against all the new guys like Daniel Bryan Danielson and Swerve. Now I think those would have been some great ass some good ass matches.
Yeah,
some good shit, pal.
the thing with the whole going back or finding a loophole, it's weird because like there's not really a loophole needed. He's not contractually. It's just his word. So all he needed to do was turn heel or just say, you know, fuck it, I'm going to do it. Like, you know, like, so that's what made that frustrating. Like nothing was stopping him. It's almost like the Batman thing. Like Batman doesn't kill. Right. But it's just because that's his morals. Doesn't mean like it's nothing really stopping him. You know, Batman, you know, the quote is always, if I kill a killer, there's the same amount of killers in the world. But it's like, not if you kill them all. Right. That's the difference. But yeah, just quick little comic reference in there too. But that's what made that most frustrating for a lot of people, I think, was, you know, like nothing is really stopping him. It's this imaginary forbidden door, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So here's my three. I'm pretty sure these are in order too. Because of the last promo he gave on Dynamite, where he's like, you know, Punk talked about going to Ring of Honor and going to New Japan, but instead he just left. And I actually did those things. I went to Ring of Honor, became a Ring of Honor world champion. I faced Okada, you know, I won the IWGP US title. I won the NWA championship against Nick Aldis. Like I did all the independent wrestling stuff that Punk glamorized and talked about doing. I thought that was going to lead to a Punk match. So that would have been, you know, it's number three because it's literally what he left off on. It was like the comma that was going to be a period, or it was a period that I thought was a comma. I thought that's where that was going. So that's number three. And number two was once Sting debuted and did that first little see around kid, they never interacted again. And I think Cody is straight up lying if he truly believes like, oh, I've wrestled everybody I wanted to wrestle there. How about your like hero outside your dad is in the locker room right next to you and you never got to do anything tag with, you know, I have Cody versus Sting, but just Cody and Sting interacting in something like they could team, they could whatever. That didn't happen. So that was kind of a bummer for me. And the last one, and I mentioned this many times on the show, and this is kind of like a two for one, Cody and Dustin winning the AEW tag titles for two reasons. One, if he's not going to win the world title, him, you know, winning every other belt at some point or another makes sense. And while we don't see Dustin a lot wrestle, he has fantastic matches every time he does. And, you know, it would be great that he's rewarded with another championship reign before he hangs it up. So that really benefits both guys. But that would be my three for sure. So, Cody, nice, what's that?
It's a nice three.
Yeah,
I didn't even think about it like that. But, yeah, man, good shit.
So that's, you know, I'm sure in the weeks and episodes to come, a lot more Cody talk will need to be had. But for now, great start. Let's see where it goes, I guess. I'm going to let you take this next one, the Charlotte Flair, Ronda Rousey, because I've had a little trouble putting this into words. I'm going to say this was good when it could have been great, but I'll let you take it from there.
Yeah, you hit it right on the head, bro. Like it was okay. I enjoyed what it was. But I do think it could have definitely went into another gear. I definitely felt like they rushed it.
Mm-hmm.
Even though on here it says it was 18 minutes.
Didn't feel that way.
Yeah, it definitely didn't. I feel like there's more that's gonna happen because Ronda did get the visual tap out.
So I could
definitely see that happening at WrestleMania Backlash, and that's where Charlotte would drop it.
Mm-hmm.
But then why not just do it there? You know,
yeah.
That was my same gripe with Stand and Deliver as well. But but I mean, it was a decent match. It was what it was. I love Charlotte. I love Rhea. I love Ronda. I think Ronda is definitely getting better in the sports entertainment world.
Mm-hmm.
She needs to be a heel. I don't like her as a baby face.
Yeah.
I'd rather her be a heel just because she likes to talk shit.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to hear her talk shit instead of smiling and all this mumbo jumbo that she does on SmackDown now.
Yeah. So there was the rumor that Ronda kind of phoned this in because she was almost insulted that she wasn't the main event. But she's kind of come out on Twitter and like squashed that. It's like, so this is apparently a rumor going around. Not true in the slightest. If for no other reason, like if the main event was, you know, for night one was, maybe if it was the other women's title match and they felt slighted to go over that one, maybe, but like, it's like, I'm right under Stone Cold Steve Austin. Like that's okay with me.
Yeah.
And if
you think about it, to WWE standards, the last three matches usually is the main event.
Yeah. The way they do their big shows for sure.
Yeah.
And like, it could be possible that she did feel that way a little bit, but after thinking about it, you know, kind of saving face, but like, you know, I think people wouldn't have said that if the match was just a tiny bit better, or maybe it was just clunky the way the finish unfolded and everything. But it was, again, it was good, not great. I'm interested what they do if they just run it back, like you said, and knowing the way WWE books some stuff, like she'll just win it on Backlash and make everybody wonder what the point was.
Yep.
So next up, and this was another thing you kind of waited with bated breath because you did the Kevin Owens show portion of this. Austin comes out, glass shatters. What I kept saying, because, you know, he's going to pull a Sting, obviously. If he's doing anything, he's wrestling in a t-shirt, right? And I kept saying, I'm like, that shirt's not tight. Like, it's like Austin's weight is not that he's ever really had an issue with his weight or anything, but like, he's probably in really good shape. And like, one of the benefits of being bald is you don't age. Like, somebody put up the picture of like Austin at WrestleMania 19. And 38 and like, oh, then the attire looked exactly the same. Maybe he put some stuff in the goatee, you know, I couldn't really tell if he did, but you know, maybe, yeah. And they did the whole, this is another thing of like, if you knew the ingredients that you were going to play with, like just cook the meal, let us know you're cooking the meal. Like, even if this was like the week before, like turn it into an actual match, because I love Stone Cold Steve Austin, but I wouldn't have tuned in if it was truly going to be just the KO show. I wouldn't have tuned in just for that.
Yeah.
Like, if you're a lapsed fan and I could have told somebody, like, you know, I got plenty of friends that used to watch wrestling that don't anymore. But if I call, like, my cousin barely watches wrestling. Stone Cold is his absolute favorite. If I could call him and say, dude, Austin's getting in the ring, like, you gotta either come over or get Peacock or whatever, he would have done it. But I can't call him and be like, he's going to sit in the ring and argue with Kevin Owens and maybe give him a stunner. Because we've seen him since his retirement, he stunned damn near half the roster, including every McMahon and Brian Saxton. So, like, that's not much of a difference. But this match, for what it was, again, no holds barred match. This was a fight, not a match. When they went out into the crowd and it looked like Austin was going to suplex KO on the concrete, that alone made me think that's going to hurt Steve's back. And he's the one giving the move. So when they reversed it and Austin took a straight up suplex on the concrete, I jumped at it. Like, I think it's the only thing that made me visibly like get out of the chair. I was like, oh my God. And then they go on the, it's kind of like since Punk's been back, he's gotten body slams over like they haven't since the 70s, you know, and he did this with suplexes. They did two big suplexes on the ramp. Once they fought all the way over to there, what stomped a mud hole, maybe a clothesline or two. I really need to watch his back. Cause I was, after that suplex, like, I kind of got hazy. Like, I knew I was watching it, but I'm like, I cannot believe.
Yeah, you can't comprehend what's going on. Yeah.
So honestly, I do need to go back and watch this. But I remember the suplexes on the ramp. Obviously, he stomped a mud hole Owens gets a stunner on him, and it looks like he might actually steal it, kick out. That he sends him off the ropes, another stunner, you know, from Austin this time, 1, 2, 3. Said 13 minutes. I would say 3 of that was in the ring, including like the opening minute and a half, closing minute and a half. Everything else was the fight around of the stage. So it was perfect. And I weirdly think this isn't the last time. I think it might it might be Saudi Arabia because he can get that Saudi money.
Yeah.
But yeah, this was, again, if I knew this was going to be, I would have made a few phone calls. And like I did after the fact, I'm like, yeah, go on YouTube, dude. You got to see this. Like, had we known this was what it was going to be, I'd have called several people and be like, you got to come over because we're already watching it, or you need to check this out. And that's that's like the one fault on that, I guess.
Yeah, man. I enjoy this so much because you already know I'm a diehard Stone Cold fan.
Oh yeah.
And when I heard the Shattered Glass, I almost pissed myself because I was like, okay, this is real. And a little backstory real quick. When I was first diagnosed with lupus, I don't know, I forgot which WrestleMania it was, but it was the WrestleMania where with Stone Cold, Mick Foley, and Shawn Michaels came out and basically like destroyed the Legion,
League of Nations or whatever.
Yeah, League of Nations with Sheamus, Rusev, and
is that 30?
It could be 30.
Maybe. I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
But yeah, when I was hype and I had heart failure at the time. So my mom, like I'm literally in my mom's living room, like, oh, I'm freaking out, bro. Cause it's Stone Cold. So like that wasn't even a match.
Yeah.
That I was giddy like that.
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine how I was when he was actually in a match? When that bell rung, bro, that's when I knew it was real, bro.
So when the bell rung, I'm like, he could just run at him and give him a stick. Like, remember when The Rock did the Eric Rowan match?
Yes.
Match. Yes. I'm like, I was expecting that. I'm like, he's going to run at him. He might give him like the couple right hands into a stunner. But the second that didn't happen, and like I said, from the suplex on the concrete, my mind just like I do need to go back and watch it. But this was this was crazy, and that's how the night ends. And I remember thinking, I'm like, shit, we got to do this again tomorrow. Like, and I don't know that I. And again, I've spoke to some people that have been there, and it's like that's really like imagine going to the Super Bowl, and then it ends at halftime. You're like, all right, come back tomorrow to see the rest. Like, it'd be really hard to get up for that energy again, you know? Like,
oh, yeah, bro.
And I do think it affected, and they did their damnedest on night two, but I think part of the reason night one just had more energy was, like, I mean, if you take out some of these fluff matches or put them on the pre-show, put some of these other guys in the Battle Royal, we had 16 matches. We could have got this down to 10, 11, or 12, and it could have been in one night. And granted, yes, I know, like, oh, they sold 140,000 tickets because 140,000, yeah, because they sold 70 on each night in a place that holds 100, so they didn't sell out, but I mean, they did it twice, so in a way I get the math of like, yeah, plus 40,000 tickets, but you also had to rent Jerry World for two nights instead of one, so I don't know if that, I don't know the math and I don't know their books, but like I don't know if that's really worth it at that point. And here's the other thing, I enjoyed the, if NXT was the main event night, like at night at the NBA arena next to the stadium in town, like it's been in years past.
Mavericks, right? Yeah.
Yeah, where the Mavericks and the Stars and all that shit play, like, which is where Raw was, which is where Stand and Deliver ended up being anyway. And yeah, there was no, like, I don't know. We're about to get into night two here and we might pick up the pace a little bit, but like, I'm not in love with it. And it's obvious they've already, next year's SoFi Stadium, two nights again. This was a little easier to take, and granted it was full stadium. That's the other difference to being in Tampa last year where we didn't have full stadium and the rain and all that shit made it weird, but not in love with two nights still, especially because of all the other stuff. And obviously WWE doesn't care about the other indie stuff going on, but like, it does make it harder to follow that stuff too. But
yeah.
I'll let you take the first few here. The kicking off of night two, like, this is how you kick off with a tag team match. Cause
yes,
RK-Bro is so over, and everybody in this match did exactly what they needed to do. And you, yeah, take it away. This was a fun start.
I wanted to say first, the right team won. Because yeah. Randy Orton and Matt Riddle are fucking over. Oh my God. When Randy Orton got the hot tag, bro, mm-hmm. it was done for. And one thing also like I'm a sucker for triple threat tag team matches when one person of each team is in the ring at the same time.
Yes, that was so much better than what because they do the women's match and they don't let them do that. I guess maybe because it was four, but yeah.
But still, man, if you're going to do three, man, you might as well just do four. Mm-hmm. So once I saw all three, I was like, okay, I'm gonna love this match just because I hate the fact that let's say it's me, you're in tag team, and Billy and Jake is a tag team, and Luke and Kramer is a tag team. Shouts out to all of them boys.
Yep, shout out. We're going over, by the way. If that match happens, we're going over.
I started a match with Kramer, and he could just tag fucking Billy.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't like that. I don't like the fact that I could just go ahead and tag someone else to get into the match.
This was the first time I know that they've done it that way, honestly. I don't remember them ever doing it like that.
They've done it multiple times. They've done it for like on NXT a lot.
Okay, they do see have that, the triple threat. But like on like a main roster thing, I don't remember them ever doing it.
Not for the most part. Mm-hmm. For the most part, not. I think the last one they did when it was basically the same guys, because that's the one on Raw. When Randy Orton and RK Bro won the titles the last time, mm-hmm. they did that the same format, and I loved it, man. I loved every second of it. Yeah. The Avalanche RKO from fucking Matt Riddle.
Yeah.
Mwah. Fucking perfect, bro. Perfect. And I love Chad Gable, and I'm starting to love Otis a lot.
I didn't think I'd like him more this way, but I'm starting to, because you got to take him a little. Like if this Otis would have won Money in the Bank, you'd have been like, maybe.
Yeah, I could see him as a champion.
Yeah,
I could see it. Mm-hmm. And it was fucking great, bro.
So after this, they did the Gable Stevenson, Stevenson, right? Stevenson. I always messed that up.
Stevenson,
Gable Stevenson. And if had we been able to do our true preview show, my conspiracy theory was that Rollins's opponent was going to be Stevenson. So that obviously didn't happen, but I did want to put it out there. I was wrong, but I was very high on that theory going into it. I just want to make sure. I like to point out when I'm right. So I'll point out when I'm wrong as well. But, and it's funny that Gable might be his, you know, Chad Gable might be Gable Stevenson's first real thing whenever he gets going. I think he's still got some training to do. Before.
Yeah. And I don't know if you saw when the camera was on them, if you saw his brother was there with them, which I hate the fact that they don't acknowledge that that's his brother.
Yeah.
I don't like that. Like, cause his brother's in NXT.
Yeah.
They could have said, they could have been like NXT superstar, Kemp. Yeah. I saw when I went to last week, he was in Level Up. Mm-hmm. And I believe he beat one of the guys from the Grizzly Young Veterans. So okay. I was like, yeah, he's actually decent. He's he wrestles like a wrestler. Mm-hmm. So it was like, show some love, man. Show some fucking love.
Yeah. It's funny that they did this and they brought him out, you know, the first night and just let him wave to people or whatever. But like, I find it almost kind of weird that they did that just because, like, I don't think we're going to see him. Maybe we're going to see him sooner than I think at this rate. But yeah, I think it's still going to be a little while.
He is on Raw.
Apparently. Yeah, that's true. So Bobby Lashley beat Omos in the shortest planned match of the night. I'll call it that. I'm glad Bobby won, at least. Like, yeah. I'm not a big Omos guy. The thing they did on Raw where MVP is now with Omos, that's going to be interesting. Probably a good move because Bobby doesn't need the mouthpiece much anymore. He's got all that pedigree, right? Yep. And Omos definitely does. Actually want to do something with them. If they don't, I don't really care. I don't care if I never see Omos again, really. So this was quick. At least Bobby got, you know, some sort of a mania moment by slaying the giant. They did make it seem like a big deal when he slammed him and beat him and speared him. That spear to the back was weird. I don't know if Omos was supposed to turn around, but then Brock did the same thing. So was that just like, we're working the back tonight, kid? Like, is that where they were going with this? I don't know.
I said the same thing, and I was listening to the Wrestle Talk podcast, and they was like,
he speared his back.
And we also forgot to mention how McIntyre is the first person to kick out the End of the Days.
You're right. We did miss that. And I'm glad that they didn't miss that, because that is true. And that is a huge deal. I'm glad that was, if you want to tell me that was the reason to do that match was so we could do it on this stage, I would say fair enough. Like, that good. Definitely glad you were able to, you brought that back up. If you are a casual wrestling fan, or, you know, just watch stuff, because, you know, like with me, people come over.
You talking about the next match?
Yes. If you are someone like that, this was probably your favorite match of the night, because it was almost mine too. I gotta say. I was really thinking this was going to be a cinematic match for a minute that would just bring out all the Jackass crew or whatever. Of course, we're talking Johnny Knoxville versus Sami Zayn. And now that this is passed, I wish this was for the Intercontinental title.
I feel that. I enjoyed this match a lot. This is what I was talking about when I was being entertained. This match right here made me entertained for the whole. This match and three matches later.
Yeah,
four matches later made me entertained.
Mm-hmm. So there was this match had pyro while someone was on the top ropes.
Yep,
it's had Mark Henry and Mae Young's son. This match had a giant mouse trap, but nothing made me pop more than a simple body slam done by one Mr. Wee Man.
Mr. Wee Man.
Was fantastic, dude. And I used to play the shit out of Tony Hawk's Underground 2, and that's when they brought in Jera and all his crew. And I had more fun than I did skating around as Wee Man. So to see him come out there, beer gut and all, Let's just put it out there. The fact that he got him up, I'm like, oh, that's cool. But when he held him there, I don't know that anything got a bigger pop in this match.
Because
you had to soak in the moment.
Yeah, man. It was a mean ass delay slam, bro. It was awesome, bro.
And if you saw my tweet, the fact that, because Sami Zayn is one of the best in-ring workers they had.
Oh, yeah.
So for him to put on this show, he deserves a world title run. Based on this.
Oh, yeah. I did see that.
I don't know who else could have pulled this. KO, maybe, because he does have that humor to him a little bit. We saw when he was like buddies with Jericho and stuff. I don't know who else pulls this off as well as he did. Like Corbin, for example, it'd be funny, but it wouldn't have looked as good, you know, if you had all these guys beating up Corbin, I guess. But like, perfect. This is Sami Zayn being one of a kind. Just fantastic. Just loved it. Loved everything about it. It's probably going to give Jim Cornette an aneurysm.
I was just about to say that, bro. Because before we started, I was listening to his review.
Oh, don't tell me.
I'm not going to. Okay. But I will say he spoke about this match about like 20 minutes.
I can't wait.
So
have them all saved to listen to at work tomorrow. So
it's on YouTube right now.
Because I saw him start popping up, so I was like, watch later. Yeah,
bro, that's exactly what I subscribe to his channel just for like for the other stuff, like all these, like when he does Dynamite stuff, when he does the NXT, the Raw type stuff.
You know, see, some people don't realize, we'll take a quick detour here and then we're really gonna pick up the pace, I think. But
yeah,
Jim Cornette, I don't have to agree with anything he says, but it doesn't mean I'm not entertained by him giving his opinion, you know?
Cornette. Especially when he's being Jim Cornette.
Cornette figure on the desk still. I think it's over. I have it on the shelf now. But I enjoy listening to his take on things, even if I think he's 100% wrong. I don't usually think he's 100% wrong. He might be like, I missed the mark here a little bit. Like, I agree with him in principle a lot. It's just like, I can have fun with some stuff that he doesn't want to have fun with, which is fine. Yeah. But shout out to Cornette. And I very much look for, because there's plenty of other stuff on this show that he will probably enjoy, like Cody stuff and you know, Austin and Owens, he'll probably applaud them for doing this safely, you know, like plenty of stuff. But yeah, great thing. And it was all over Twitter, all over everything. Everybody loved it. Wrestling fans and not, which is for Mania, that is something you're trying to do. You know?
I want to say shout out to Johnny Knoxville.
Yeah.
Because that mousetrap fucking malfunctioned. Mm-hmm. And he knew exactly what to do. He took a lick because that damn
spring, down
that shit
him, yeah.
hit his ass in the back of the head. Mm-hmm. But he was a constant pro and he was able to do it. And shout out to Sami Zayn too. Like you said, Sami Zayn deserves a raise, a championship run. I don't care if it's a tag team. I don't care if it's an IC. Hell, mm-hmm. give him a chance against Roman. Even if it's a quick little match.
Yeah, just let a main event a pay per view.
Just let a main event because that motherfucker right there.
Yeah, watch him win the IC title back right from Ricochet now that he's done with the Knoxville stuff. Just like, all right, where were we? this next the women's tag match, like I think more people talked about the entrances than the match itself. This was just whatever it was. So, you know, I was happy for Naomi and Sasha though. Like, I didn't realize why Sasha was so emotional, and then I realized because I think they eventually said it. It was Sasha's first WrestleMania win. So if you got to kind of throw this match together, you know, at least you got something positive came out of it. So that's interesting. Next up on paper, this was the match I was most looking forward to. Just looking at person A, person B are going to have fight. Edge and AJ this was another good, not great. I think they kept it a little slow and methodic because it fit the story. So it's like these guys had another gear. I think we all know that, but they just chose not to use it, which is okay. But that's not really how you tackle a Mania match, in my opinion. Like maybe you do if you'd have done this at like the Rumble and then led to the All Out match at Mania, that makes more sense. But I am very intrigued with where it goes next, which I don't know that it'll involve AJ necessarily, but the Damian Priest thing and their kind of buddy buddy. And they might add some more people to that group. I don't think they have a name yet or anything, but
there is reports that Edge is going to be having it's going to be Damian Priest, Rhea Ripley.
Yeah, I read the Ripley thing
and Tommaso Ciampa apparently.
I'm all for that.
Which I'm all for that, bro. Like when I saw Damian Priest out there, I was like, oh, they're doing it.
Yep,
they're fucking doing it.
And I like Priest. It sucks
though because I wanted Priest to go for a big title, mm-hmm. having instead of a singles run, but I'm okay with it. I'm 100% in his long term booking. If you think about it,
yeah, because if they're not ready for him to be a world champion, this is a great spot to put him in the meantime. Yep. So this is perfect. The next thing, so the New Day match got bumped for night one because of video packages. Did you know on night two? There was an hour and 33 minutes of video package on night two. Night one couldn't have been much less. I think it was an hour 12, I think somebody said. They end up getting this match. Again, you had a two-hour pre-show. Could have gave them 25 minutes if you wanted to. If nothing else to make up for it, right? The New Day come out in Big E-inspired gear, which right here. Thought that was awesome. Yes. Great stuff. This match is clocked at 1:40, and I don't know that it was that long. Sad. And keep in mind, the reason this match happened is because they originally wanted to do all three of the New Day for Sheamus, Rich Holland, and Butch, right? Pete Dunne. That didn't happen because Big E broke his neck building this storyline. And then the culmination of the storyline that he broke his neck in gets 1:40. That's bullshit. I don't care what else you could have bumped. Not that anyone deserves to be bumped, obviously. So I'm not even looking at somebody. Move the Fatal 4-Way Women's Tag to the pre-show. Like, move something like that. Even if this match is on the pre-show, if it's the only match on the pre-show, it still feels kind of special at that point, you know?
Now, see, I was utterly pissed off about this. Yeah. This was the worst match of both nights, of the whole weekend, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Because everything else was better than this.
Yeah, good enough. Yeah.
Good. Yeah, it was good enough to actually this deserved to be here on WrestleMania or on this night type shit. Mm-hmm. But I'm a big fan of both Kofi and Xavier, and of course I love Big E. And they didn't deserve this, bro.
No. And again, it's not like we all know what Sheamus is. We all respect Sheamus.
Yeah, contribution. Yeah, Sheamus is one of my favorites, bro. Yeah.
Rich Holland is young and could maybe end up being something good. I hate the Butch character, but we know how great Pete Dunne is. So yes. it has nothing to do with the guys they wrestled, obviously.
It's just a terrible spot. I don't care if the New Day lost. Give them time, bro. Mm-hmm. A minute and 40 seconds.
I still feel like they should have won, but yeah, like if you do it right, like they, you know, they're bulletproof. Like they, it's not an issue of them winning or not. 100% agree. This pissed me off, and luckily the next match made me very happy. when Pat McAfee comes out to Seven Nation Army, which was just a big get, Vince using licensed music. He came out with the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders. I felt like that was
like make no sense.
He was like, well, he played football. It's like, yeah, yes. But not for this team. Like, I mean, it was cool. Like, I mean, Pat said it was cool. He enjoyed, like, he talked about it on his show. Pat was on his show the next day in the same clothes he was on in the day before in the match, and either drunk or high or both. And it was a beautiful thing to watch and listen to. Definitely go check out his, like, if not the whole show, his chunk where he talks about this. But the match was great because Pat, and keep in mind, this is Pat's third match ever, first in front of people, and it's 70,000 people.
Yep.
I was a little taken back by him not wearing gear. I will just say, the second he came out, I'm like, oh, okay. Like, wrestling in tight jeans. That's a bold statement here, but I mean, it didn't seem to deter him at all. It was like when he wrestled Adam Cole in NXT, like he had like shorts and knee pads and boots and a tank top. And like, I was expecting something like that. Austin Theory did exactly what he needed to do. Pat clearly loves the jump to the top rope and do the superplex spot. That's his thing. And I love it because he's actually the only one that does it. So it does make him feel like, just from a pure wrestler standpoint, makes him feel valuable.
Yep.
He does win with a roll up. I wouldn't have minded a slightly more decisive move to beat him. I don't know what I would have expected. Even just like big DDT, tight pin hook, and he can't quite get out of it. Like, you know, I don't know quite what it needed to be, but like,
I
would have been a little more decisive would be my only note.
I was hoping that he was going to hit that punt.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, if he would have hit the punt and then pin him, I would have been fine with that. Yeah. I love this match so much.
I
fucking loved it, and I know Pat McAfee loved it. And like he said, listeners or watchers, whatever, if you don't have nothing to do, watch his show that happened on Monday.
Yeah,
because I loved how he talked about that. He got his first win. He's undefeated at WrestleMania, and the other shit that happened, you know, that didn't count.
Yeah, he's like that couldn't have been a sanctioned match, right? All his crew was like, no, of course not. And here's the thing: like, I would have actually preferred, like, it didn't need to be a match. Like, Vince could have done, like, obviously he's bumping and feeding his ass off, which total pro. The way McAfee did it, almost looked believable. It almost looked like, oh, he's really like knocking him over. Like, he could have just done that a few times with Austin Theory nutshotting him and everything. Have Austin come out. You still could have gotten the worst stunner in recorded human history out of it, you know, which we did, in fact, get. Didn't need to be a match. It doesn't really matter. Like, no, honestly, nobody's going to remember that part. They're going to remember him.
Everyone's gonna win it,
and then Austin coming out.
Yes,
that's
yes.
all they're gonna remember. So whatever. Remember. If it made Vince feel better, fine. It did not deter my enjoyment of the Theory match in the slightest. Whatever, Vince. That punt was weak, though. That is one thing.
Bro, I see the replay of that shit, and I'm like, he barely hit the ball, bro. He tapped. He barely hit Pat. Yeah.
Yeah. So that'd be my biggest drawback on that, I guess.
And but I will say this. You would think this is definitely how high they think of Pat McAfee.
Yeah.
One, he is over. He had the second biggest pop of the whole weekend, bro.
Yeah.
And it was going on the whole time, bro.
So I'd say third. I'd say Austin, Cody.
Yeah, Cody. Yeah, you're right.
But still, top three on a WrestleMania for a guy that's had his third match.
Third match, bro. It was amazing. It was fucking awesome. And damn, what else gonna say? Fuck.
Oh, the fact that they trusted him with Vince. I assume.
Yes, they trusted him with Vince. Austin Theory is a constant pro as well, bro. His second WrestleMania, and he's taking the pin for Pat McAfee. Gotta love it, bro. Yeah. Gotta love it.
And let's just throw this out there too. He commentated matches on night one and two leading up to his match.
Yep.
So, you know,
I think the only matches he didn't commentate was the Sheamus, Ridge, and of course his own.
Yeah.
And main event.
Right. Yeah. That makes sense. Speaking of the main event, nice segue there. the fact that this was billed as like the most important match. This is the match I knew I was going to get because Brock only has one match, right? Mm-hmm. He breaks the barricade, spam finishers. They did it a little longer. This went over 10 minutes, which is a little rare for Brock, I guess. And for people that have enjoyed Hillbilly Brock, like, cool, because I don't think most people enjoyed lame Brock from before. So if people got enjoyment out of this run and we got to see Brock a little more of his human side, like, I'm all for that. I'm not a fan of Brock Lesnar, but like, he was way more entertaining recently than he has been. But they've overdone it. They with stories of like, Brock has been hanging out in Gorilla and giving guys tips on their matches. What is he going to tell them? Have you tried suplexing him? Because that works for me. And he had the gall to be on, I think it was on Pat's show, where he's like, guys need to get more creative in the ring and they have to. I'm like, dude, you do four moves. I'm glad people have enjoyed Lesnar more lately, but like when I heard stuff like that, I was just like, that's the same old dude. Like, granted, he's putting in a little more than the bare minimum that he's done since he came back in 2012, 11, whenever it was. The Roman thing was interesting about the potential dislocation, and we still don't know the full story. Apparently, we're going to learn on SmackDown, which was weird how they made us wait all the way to the end of Raw to find that out, apparently. I hope it's not like a vacate the belt type situation. I hope it's not that big of an injury, but like,
I don't think so.
The moment was still great. I still don't know that they plan to truly unify these titles. I don't think they really know what that word means. They are calling it the WWE universe. Like, they combined the name.
Yeah. WWE Universal
Undisputed champion or something.
Undisputed. Yeah. like that.
So Roman won, which was the right move. If Brock won, I'd be like, what the hell are we doing here? So, you know, WrestleMania was crazy. This was, and it's weird to just say it on a note like that, but like, we've seen this match 1,000 times and I hope we never get it again. I hope we never hint at it again. The one storytelling element I like is this is the first time Roman's beat Brock at a Mania. So like, the story at least makes sense. I'll give him that. It was fine. It was maybe a tick better than some of the other ones they had. But that's all I got for that.
I'll say this. I'll be okay with it again. But give me 2 years of a break of it. You know? Don't just go running right back up again next year.
I mean, if we're still counting on Brock Lesnar to do a big event in 2 years, then WWE's still in trouble at that point. But I mean, I get what you mean. Like, sure, I guess there is a situation that it could happen, but you know, you never know.
Yeah, because what's the actual record between the two? Like, do we know that?
So, like, for Manias?
Oh, well, all together.
Oh, I don't know exactly, but I know, like, Brock beat him once. The other one, Seth cashed in. So he was, you know, 0-1-1 against him at Manias. And then I think Brock's beat him at, like, Saudi and beat him at, like, SummerSlam. So he never really, like, beat him. So that story's there, which is fine. Quick note too on the post WrestleMania Raw, and I need you to tell me if I'm wrong about this or not. That crowd sucked, and unless
I think it was, go ahead.
Just my and other theory was it maybe potentially just mic'd poorly? Is that possible? Because this thing sucked.
Now I have some people on TikTok that actually was at the Raw.
Okay.
And they said that it was a lot louder because they actually recorded it and everything. But what I think it was, what people was drained, bro.
Yeah, of course. Like, that makes total sense. I mean,
yeah.
Four you, nights you think of about stuff, it. Really?
I mean, yeah, bro.
Factoring SmackDown and the Hall of Fame and everything.
And you factor in if they was at NXT.
Yeah.
Or if they went to GCW or Ring of Honor.
Yep.
It was a long weekend. I think it'll get better.
Yeah.
For Friday and next in the following week. I think that's the reason why it wasn't as star studded like a usual Raw after Mania. I believe like next week you'll start seeing like it'll be more pops and shit.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the thing that just got me is like, so they finally gave you Veer, right? And like, ironically, people wanted Veer and to the point that it wasn't ironic and they just wanted to see this guy. And granted, the way they debuted him wasn't great, but his pop was,
oh yeah,
nothing, dude. Yeah. I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, like I don't really care about the guy. He might end up being great, but like he came out, I'm like, oh boy, here we go. Like for the pop at least, and no, nothing. Like Cody still got his decent pop in the beginning, I'll say.
Yep.
But it took a minute. He almost had to like will it out of them. He had to do was like, come on, but you know, that was about it. Now, again, I do want to say wrestling, so. I get it, but
yeah,
that will be one of the casualties of two night WrestleManias is the Raw after Mania might not be a thing as much anymore. That's going to be the biggest casualty, 100%. I think.
Yeah, that might be the what's going to suck it out. What's going to suck about it? I do want to make a quick side note.
Sure.
Ezekiel,
God, I almost
is one of my favorite characters right now.
All right, let's put a pin in that.
I'm going to let you know right now. Oh, well, okay, good. Yeah, yeah.
No, you finished the thought. I was going to, in general, though, we're going to put a pin in that and bring up Ezekiel next week. I think we need to.
Next, okay. Okay. Yeah.
Because I need to see more about what they're doing with it. Yeah. But
I will say this. Mm-hmm. If they do something, because I don't know if you follow Elias on Twitter.
I might. I don't know.
Elias's Twitter page, it says this is Ezekiel.
Yeah, he changed it. Yeah.
Yeah, he changed it to the younger brother of Elias.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to see what they do with it. I want to see if they're gonna lean into him being the younger brother. And I love the fact that Kevin Owens basically said, no, you're not. You're Elias.
Like, dude, like we used to ride together. Like we know who you are. Like
that was perfect.
And he came out in like Cena ruthless aggression, like he was gonna slap Kurt Angle. Like,
yeah.
I don't know where that's gonna go. We've gone here for a little bit. We're probably over the hour mark that we like to shoot for. But before we get out of here, this is gonna be a Donovan segment. He was at NXT yesterday, and if you don't believe him, look at his cover photo on Facebook. something went down, and we're not going to talk about the MSK thing yet. We're going to let that play out. We're going to mention that next week as well. Put a pin in that as well. But what went down at NXT? Because something was funky yesterday.
All right, so I don't know if you guys have been on Twitter. I don't know if you watched NXT, but the crowd was really, really rowdy from the first fucking segment. So when I got there, I seen these guys, and this one dude in particular, he was speaking very, very loudly. So I was like, okay, he's gonna be an issue.
He's gonna be a problem. Yeah.
Yes, he's gonna be a problem. So he's literally sitting two rows behind me, and if you look at the cover picture, he's the guy that's standing up with his hands up and the blue shirt on.
Okay.
He was the motherfucker that was basically saying, not my champion, to Bron Breakker.
Okay.
And he was screaming this shit from when he came out for the segment, for the opening segment, to when the match actually happened. And it's crazy because I was actually on Twitter at the same time as I was there because I wanted to see like what people were reacting, how people were reacting to the show.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, this crowd is being like their asses. Everyone is asses there because you can hear all the side talk and stuff. And like, and I can understand, yes, you're there for, you know, voice your opinion, you do what you want to do.
Yeah.
But there's a limit sometimes, bro. Let the people work, bro.
Let the other people enjoy it too.
Like, yes.
And here's the thing, and like we talked about this for a minute before we got on, but like NXT is not the easiest show to gain access to. There's a bit of a process. So for you to go through that process to be a dick is just another level of asshole that I don't possess in my body. I know that much. Yep. But and it's like, even if like back when NXT was easy to get to, right? Just show up at Full Sail, you know, an hour before, you're probably going to get in, right? That used to be the easy way. You know, again, boo who you want to boo, but it just sounds like people use the word, oh, the fans hijacked the show. People use that a little loosely. This sounds like a real attempt from what I gather.
You know? It definitely was. And you could see all the, like, I'm surprised the NXT, WWE NXT crowd wasn't trending on fucking Twitter.
Mm.
I'm surprised about that shit.
Well, hopefully that is a one-time thing because, like, NXT, again, and the other thing is, it is truly the developmental project here now. So, like, if you do that on Raw, granted the arena is bigger, you're probably just going to get drowned out. But, like, you're not as equipped to handle it if you're a straight out of performance editor. Granted, yeah. Bron Breakker could probably, like, you know, it sucks. And granted, he would have gotten in trouble for doing this, but like when Moxley came back from rehab and the one guy yelled something at him and he was just like, get the fuck out of here. Like, I wouldn't have blamed Bron for doing that. He probably would have had some like throwback, but like, that's how you have to handle that situation. I guess you just got to like blitzkrieg the dude. But like, so was it just the one guy mostly, or was it?
Well, for Breakker, it was the one guy, but then for like Tony D'Angelo and AJ, whatever his name, the other guy that Tony D'Angelo came out with, at Stand and Deliver. Mm-hmm. He was basically like, you're not a real Italian. He was just yelling this shit out, like, randomly, bro.
I'm pretty sure he is. Like, he's not off the boat. Like, I'm not off the boat. I'm still Italian, you know? Like,
bro, calm down, bro. Like I said, I understand you want to voice your opinion, but other people are trying to enjoy. Yeah. Other people are trying to sit here and listen to what the promos are. You don't got to keep on being rowdy.
Yeah.
And there was even an Ezekiel chant. We want Ezekiel. And then there was also a We Want Ziggler chant. Like, what the fuck? Who wants that?
Yeah.
Who wants that? And then the only time I would say that the crowd was actually right to chant was when there was a double count out between Dexter Lumis and Duke Hudson. Because they was like, that was stupid. Yeah. And the cameras caught that. And I was
fine. Double countouts are rarely the way to go. So yeah,
yes. Yeah, but that's the only one I'll be okay with.
Yeah. So hopefully, you know, that's not something that becomes a pattern and you know, people can go back to enjoying NXT, because nobody really like you put it perfectly, let people work, right?
Yep.
And to quote, you know, Brian Zane, like what you like, but don't be a dick. And that's what it comes down to. So
that's exactly what they was.
Hopefully that's a one-time thing. If you guys watched this all the way to the end, we appreciate it. We had a lot to cover, and I think we did a great job with it. We're going to get back on a regular schedule, and we hope you guys had a stupendous WrestleMania weekend. And we thank you all for watching and listening, and we'll see you guys next time.